wet lubricants have similar issues. They include temperature changes, lubricant depletion, hard water, salt, and metallic soap buildup, metal fines, tramp oils, bacteria, yeast, and mold, and of course, other contamination issues. It's very important that these parameters be monitored closely. For temperature, we like to see the lubricants run typically between 90 and 130 degrees Fahrenheit. This provides proper wetting, detergency, and low foaming characteristics. The good wetting gives the desired interfacial tension, which helps to create that boundary lubricant between the two surfaces. It also provides good boundary lubrication when you have that wetting characteristic. Higher than normal operating temperatures cause premature oxidation of the essential lubrication additives, and you start developing excess water loss from evaporation, which leads to very rapid increase in the hard water salts that affects conductivity, which will be my next slide. And of course, running above 120 degrees tends to increase the risk of scalding. Filtration is important in that it helps to eliminate a lot of the metal fine formation that is generated during these wire drawing processes. It also helps to minimize the hard water soaps, the copper oleates, the aluminum oleates, the iron oleates or stearates as the case may be, by removing them from the solution. Now, while filtration is inexact, getting as much out of the system as possible does help to improve coolant life and, more importantly, dye life. And having longer dye life improves productivity. Concentration is extremely important. We typically run our these wet lubricants anywhere from about 5 to 15% by volume. And as the drawing process proceeds, we are pulling lubricant out of the system by plate out. It is very important to verify that there is enough lubricant additives in the system. Two methods of doing this is the use of a refractometer or a Babcock bottle with acid split. The refractometer is a very simple and fast, accurate way of determining if there is enough lubricant in the system. It is done by placing a small sample on the refractometer slide and then looking at it to see where the refractometer diffraction pattern occurs. If you have many small systems, this is a very useful instrument. If you have a much larger central lubrication system, it might be more advisable to check concentration with a Babcock bottle acid split. This method, though, does take some specialized equipment. You're handling strong acids to force the oil phase out of the aqueous method, and does take possibly up to an hour to obtain your results. Other test requirements for wet lubricants include pH. pH is very important because it is a destabilization of the lubricant. And when I refer to destabilization, I'm referring to keeping the oil phase in solution with the water phase. If the pH is too low, coolant stability is sacrificed. We start to see a lot of free oil floating on the surface. is an indication also of microbial activity, which I will address shortly. If the pH is too high, excessive foaming and skin irritation may result. Consult with your lubricant supplier as to what pH range they want their solutions operated at. Earlier, I indicated that if the solutions run at too high a temperature, you increase the water evaporation and increase the amount of hard water salts, which leads to an increase in conductivity. Conductivity measures the amount of resistance the solution has or how well the solution can conduct electricity or a current. Typically, conductivities are very low, on the order of less than 1,000 microohms. As the conductivity increases, again, this will have a tendency to destabilize the coolant, resulting in free oil floating on the surface. So again, speak with your lubricant supplier as to where they want the conductivity to be, you know, for their particular product. And then last, I want to talk to you a little bit about the microbial test. These systems are not sterile, and bacteria and other fungal molding yeast are going to grow in these solutions. The method for checking microbial activity is the use of these test strips. I recommend that the test strips or the microbial activity be checked at least once a week. They're very simple to use. You take a solution sample, you dip the slide into the solution, place the test strip back into the sterile vial, place it on a low light shelf at room temperatures, walk away from it for 48 to 72 hours, and then come back and observe the type of microbial activity that has occurred. Then, using the reference charts supplied by the test strip supplier, you can then estimate the amount of microbial activity. Generally speaking, and again, this is very dependent on the type of product that you're using, we want to keep the microbial activity below 10 to the fifth. Above 10 to the fifth creates, again, destabilization of the coolant, as the byproduct of microbial activity are acidic compounds which lower the pH. That's why I was suggesting earlier that noticing a drop in pH could be an indication of microbial activity. On the fungal side, yeast and mold, generally we want zero to none. If you have a fungal situation, that needs to be treated very rapidly and you know, with the proper microbial antimicrobial agents to remove these materials from the system. A lot of times in very large coolant systems, what we see occurring is that we get these microbial infestations inside the various plumbing. And unless the plumbing also gets cleaned out periodically, treating the main coolant system doesn't always solve the problem.
Now let's review some key points from the video.